Everyone, each time I look at these kind of introductions, you know, I just lose my confidence and I almost become nervous because this is not me. You know, I just have to just bring the expectations down. I am Anisha, I am an employee, I have worked for 28 years and I continue to work 18 hours a day. That's me. So Ranjan and I normally do a kind of a jugal bandi on Storm the Norm, and when Suresh got in touch with us and he said, you know, I want you to speak on brand, so I said, you know, okay, let's do a separate module, because normally we do combine modules. That's what we, you know, we've been doing for the last 8 months since the time the book has been launched, but this time we did decide to actually follow each other. So I'm not going to repeat what Ranjan said and do something fresh, taking off from, you know, the topic that was given to me. I think the biggest challenge that most of, you know, the SMEs and startups, and there are a lot of these kind of companies that have started approaching me for the last 1 year since I actually stopped being an employee and I started off on my own. When it comes to this word brand and marketing, people are very confused. They really don't know where to begin, what's the starting point. For many people, creating a nice ad and putting it on TV is a brand. So different kinds of things in the last 26 years that I have been, you know, creating brands, I've heard all these kind of stories. So I'm going to take a few minutes to just get the theory of what a brand is out of my mind, because that's very important. If you don't understand the science of a brand, you know, you won't know what, you know, how you would even begin to create a brand for yourself. So I have a few slides on that. And this is the book that actually came with the same purpose of, you know, these are 20 very powerful, very successful brands, okay? There are startup brands that have actually created success in the last 10 years, PVR, Make My Trip, and there are brands which have actually reinvented themselves for hundreds of years and stayed relevant, like Raymond, like MTR, like Times of India, pre-World War brands, and then there are challenger brands, you know, who have come and challenged the incumbents. So whether it's an Idea, a Tata Tea, a Kurkure, so there are various such brands inside there as well. So 20 brands, it was important to study whether you are a startup or whether you are a 100-year-old brand, you need to follow certain principles of success. So that's what, you know, created this book. For me, the best definition of a brand, and like I said, many people have different understandings. My son, you know, has just turned 18 years old and he wanted to open a bank account, okay? And we have, in our family, we have a bank account and an ICICI and an HDFC, and my daughter has it in, you know, in Axis Bank. And now my son has turned 18. And so he wanted to open a bank account. So we told him, I was telling him, I have an account in ICICI Bank. I told him, okay, you open an account in ICICI. So my daughter has an account in Axis Bank. So she says, no, 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 Axis is okay, this thing. Now, this kid actually turns around and he says, but I remember, Mom, last time you were trying to do an online transaction, you actually struggled because you said this ICICI online transaction sucks. I remember your word, you said it sucks. Okay, and I am not, I will only do transactions online. I have no intentions of going to the bank, whatever. So no ICICI for me. Now what happened? There was a conversation about a brand and a choice of a brand being taken inside a room where I am trying to pitch a bank, but my son recalls that one comment that I had made, that it sucks because I was frustrated and the system just kept hanging and I couldn't transfer the money. And he says, no ICICI for me. Now brand is what, you know, people say about you when you are not in the room. That's what is the best definition of brand. And that was said by the CEO of Amazon, Jeff, because a true test is, what are people saying behind your back? You know, what are they saying? And you can pick examples of these kind of conversations that you do in your drawing rooms. A choice of a car, you know, how easily you trivialize, you know, a very powerful brand because of one small experience that you would have, a negative experience that you would have had. So that's the power of a successful brand. A brand is not in your possession. I, as a brand marketer all my life, can tell you that it's not in my control, the opinions that people have about me. Okay? It rests in consumers' mind. The feelings that they have about your brand, positive and negative, the emotions that they have, the connect that they have. Do I relate to this brand or I don't relate to this brand? They might have had a positive experience, but I don't connect with it. It's not my kind of brand, you know. I will never go to a Vistara Airlines because it's not my kind of brand. I always prefer Jet Airways or vice versa, whatever. So people have feelings, people have emotions about the brand, and there's very little that you can do to control it. Okay? So if brands belong to customers, how do you control it? You know, what is your role in building the brands? You know, what do you do, you know, to influence what people are thinking? You can only influence it, by the way. You can't actually just be in their mind and make them go through it. And that's why I said it's a very scientific process. Okay, customers form opinions about products or services based on perceptions. So there is a fact and there's a perception. Both these things are equally important. There's a reality, there's a fact, and then there is a perception. That perception gets shaped by many things. That perception could be your own experience. That perception could be the advertisement that you see. That perception could be my neighbor's experience with that category. That perception could be, you know, 15 years back, you know, somebody said something. That perception could be social media is saying something about some brand. Perceptions are very, very, very difficult things to manage in building a brand. Experience you can still manage. So it's a combination of experience and perception that as brand owners need to keep at the back of their mind when they're building successful brands. So, you know, where does it all begin? Now, if perceptions have to be shaped, you know, where does it all begin? What do you do? What is in your control? Okay? How can you start building a brand? So what is in your control? Oh, I've got only 9 minutes remaining. That's amazing. Okay, so I don't think I can do the whole thing. So what is in your control is that you can at least start making sure that the stories people tell about your brand are the stories that you actually want them to tell. Okay, you can at least begin there. At least have a story for your brand. What is your brand story? Okay, do you have one? Do you have a clarity about what you want to stand for and what do you want the world to believe about you? If I am, and human beings, you know, are very good analogies for brands. If I am Anisha, what is my story? Okay, first I need to be clear about what my story is. If I'm not clear, the world will not relay that story for me. That I can do many things to get my story wrong in the market is a different story. But at least am I clear to begin with what is my brand story. And going forward, I'm going to rush this because there are 8 essential components that can help you define what your brand is. And these 8 are, people do not buy you for what you sell. People buy you for why you have created an offering like that, you know. So it's the why and not the what. So your brand needs to have a purpose, okay? That purpose, Patanjali, I just did a session the other day. It's become a raging success all over, you know, the country, you know, giving FMCGs a run for their money. Now, Patanjali's purpose is to eradicate diseases through natural Ayurvedic, you know, treatments in India. Now, that's their purpose. We want to eradicate diseases, okay? Now, purpose is both functional and intentional. The intentional purpose is I want to eradicate diseases through Ayurvedic treatments. The functional purpose is I want to be a 1 trillion company in the next 10 years, you know, which is almost 1/3 the size of the entire consumer packaged industries. So you need to have a purpose, and then there needs to be a, after you've defined your purpose, there's a promise. That promise is your promise to the customer, to the market. Okay?